Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming down tonight. We're absolutely delighted to be here today with Sir Nicholas Hytner. Sir Nicholas came to Cambridge to study law in 1974.
English.
Switched after 6 weeks to read English.
Oh, so I did. I forgot that.
He was very involved with the arts and theatre scene while at Cambridge, and upon graduation, got involved with opera direction first.
Yes.
And then went into directing plays and musicals, becoming Associate Director of the National Theatre and subsequently Director of the National Theatre in 2003. So can we give him a very warm welcome? So my first question is, what got you into theatre in the first place?
What got me into it?
How was your love of it kindled?
I was taken from an early age. Tell me if you want me to do anything to the mic. I was taken from an early age. That was my great good fortune. I started to get more interested in it than my family when I was a teenager. I was brought up in Manchester. Might this be my phone? Let's try it. It's on airplane mode now. Is that what you think? You think that'll be better? Yeah. Okay. So I was brought up in Manchester. There was a reasonable amount going on. When I was a teenager, there was no fringe scene in Manchester, so I was reliant on the local rep, on the reps in the towns around Manchester, which have now mostly disappeared. But what has happened in Manchester as the reps in Oldham and Bolton and all the surrounding local reps have disappeared, is that there is now a very interesting fringe scene. So I think anybody who, like me, grew up in Manchester and was introduced to it at a reasonably early age would find plenty to do. Why did I want to work in the theatre? I think anybody who wants to work in the theatre, anybody here who wants to work in the theatre, will find as they go on that they answer that question in different ways and at different levels. In some way, working in the theatre is probably like any kind of creative or quasi-creative activity, is a solution to the damage you sustain as a human being as you get older. But this is not the forum to discuss that. I thought I wanted to be an actor. Then I thought I wanted to be a writer. At Cambridge, I realized I was... I couldn't write, and I was an indifferent actor. And I like to think that the way I discovered that I was an indifferent actor was by working out the way my theatrical concentration worked, so that directing wasn't, as it were, a third best. But I think what happens is you find, if you want to act, but you are in fact a director, that the particular form of concentration that an actor needs, the ability to completely subsume oneself in one role, one way of looking at the world, to cut out the white noise of both self-consciousness and consciousness of the world around you. I didn't have that. I was always watching myself and everything around me. And that, I think, is the beginning of a director. So at Cambridge, I fell into it.
Okay. And you just said that you didn't think you were good enough to be a writer.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm particularly interested in this because, having sort of read a bit about you, you suggested to David Hare the idea of the power of yes, if I'm correct.
Mm.
And you helped Alan Bennett with The Habit of Art,
mm-hmm,
and to some degree with The History Boys.
Well, yeah, you know, during the last during the last now 11 years, I've had ideas. I've put writers together with material, with books, occasionally floated a story, sometimes had pretty complete and watertight ideas. I couldn't sit down and write the dialogue. I couldn't sit down myself and structure the play. Editing, which is, if you're dealing with a new play, material that comes to you as its first reader, is a very different activity to sitting down and writing it in the first place. Listen, I can write about the theatre. I can write about it. My God knows I've sat down and banged out 1,200, 1,800 words about the theatre and related topics over and over during the last 10 years. It's one of the jobs. But what I can't do is write effective dialogue. If you're in my position, producing plays, looking for 20 plays a year to produce, at least half of which, sometimes more, are new, the thing that pulls you in immediately is a gift for dialogue. That gets you beyond the first three or four pages. If the dialogue's flat, if the dialogue's leaden, you do give up pretty quick. I'm not sure that can be taught. I think certain principles of narrative structure can be taught. I think the various different ways that theatres are made, plays are put together, can be taught. If you don't have an ear for the way people speak or the way you want people to speak, then you're not a playwright.
Interesting. And in all your time in the theatre, be it at Cambridge or sort of subsequently at Glyndebourne, or you were at Glyndebourne or at the National, what have you been proudest of directing?
There isn't a single show. There's lots that I've enjoyed doing. I've enjoyed my relationships, with various playwrights, and I've enjoyed the work I've done with actors with whom I've had a continuing relationship. But I don't think there's one single thing. I think I'm. In retrospect, and in the present, I continue to be proud of the fact that I realized in time that directing shows, going from gig to gig, was not going to be enough for me, and that I stepped up to the plate and applied to be the director of the National Theatre and got the job. That feels like taking care of that big thing, making sure that thrived, changing it a bit, that seems a bigger and better thing to have done than one single show.
Yeah. And in your time at the National, you have done a lot with Travelex tickets and I think Entry Pass to make it more accessible and with the National Theatre Live. What more do you think can be done in the future to make the theatre more accessible?
Well, there's always, whatever more is done, it's never going to be enough. There's an odd conundrum to be solved here. By its nature, however many seats there are in a theatre, that evening's performance is going to be exclusive. That's the point, it's exclusive. There's, even in the Olivier Theatre, where there are 1,150 seats, it's 1,150 people just once that night, once only. And even if you do it 100 times, that's still reasonably exclusive. 100,000 people is exclusive. You double it by broadcasting it live, it's still only 200,000 people. As the entertainment world becomes more digital, as it becomes more available, as anybody at the touch of a mouse can get more or less anything. You know, I come from a generation where BBC Two, the invention of BBC Two, I remember it. It was a big deal. There was suddenly a third channel. and so I grew up watching two channels of television, which I think only came on air around about 5 o'clock. So to me, the fact that you now see anything at any time, anywhere, still feels pretty remarkable. But the more that happens, the more of a premium I think people put, particularly people like you, who have had everything available to you at the click of a mouse from the moment you were conscious, the more of a premium people put on live, once only, for me and a few others, on this night in this room. That thing, anybody who makes theatre, anybody who makes live entertainment, anybody who makes live performing art has got to hang on to. Digital is a huge opportunity. Look, you know, it's been one of the big things that we've done over the last 10 years. You can now see a lot of the National Theatre's work in a form that isn't quite, well, it isn't at all what it is when you sit there in the theatre watching it, but it is a really good facsimile, a really good second best. You can see it on the screen, but the thing itself is live on the night for a few people only. So the constant talk about accessibility, which must continue and must always be questioned, is always going to be fighting against the thing that makes it special in the first place. You know, there are some live performances. There are some one-night-only performances which within months you'll find hundreds of thousands of people will claim to have been there. You know, in my day, it was the night when Dylan went electric and someone shouted traitor. There's now millions of people who were there that night. I think in its way, what that is, what that says is that the power of the live event is irreducible, and although we can do lots to make sure that everybody who wants to come has a chance to come, in the end, there's a limit. And that limit is the number of times the performers are prepared to do it, the number of seats that are in the house. Having said that, maybe what you're talking about is what can we do to make sure that the audience is more diverse. Again, a limited amount. I'm afraid once people have started to elect to come to the theatre, they have elected to be part of a group that is called theatre-goers. And so they almost, by deciding to become regular theatres, lose a degree of what would have, before they decided to start coming, made them qualify for the bracket marked diversity. But we can, you know, it's not brain surgery. Cheaper tickets, it's that simple. It's cheaper tickets and good marketing.
And do you think that would work with opera? Because you said that you thought opera was a dying art or becoming a museum.
No, I've never said it's a dying art. The performance of it is not dying. The performance of it is more alive than ever. What I think is problematic about opera, and I, you know, this is uncontroversial, is that whereas 100 years ago it was popular, and it was genuinely popular in that those who were composing it were composing in something recognizable as a popular idiom, now those who compose opera simply aren't. But the same can be said about musical theater. 50 years ago, certainly pre-1956, the people who were writing musicals were writing hits. Now, the people who write hits, if they try to write musicals, find that the kind of music that you listen to commercially, the kind of music that you listen to isn't particularly susceptible to what's required by theatrical narrative. So musicals have gone off in a different direction as well. They become an art form for people who discover it, who learn about it, who can be bothered to open themselves up to an unfamiliar musical idiom. The way people compose opera now is pretty difficult for the majority of everyday listeners. So what isn't happening is the replenishment of the repertoire. That's not a problem I have at the National Theatre. The repertoire is being replenished all the time, and the thing that the general public, let alone the, I'm not saying now the specialist theatre public, the thing that the general public wants most of all is a new play, something that's going to surprise them, something they didn't know they wanted in the first place, something that makes them look at the world in a new way, a story they've never been told before. They want, you know, Jerusalem, or they want Enron, or they want something that's totally startling. Those are the big hits. The opera public doesn't. It wants nuances in, you know, Verdi's Trovatore that it's not noticed before. But by and large, what it doesn't want is someone ear-bashing them with music that it doesn't understand. Yep. So that's why. But the performance of the classical repertoire in opera houses is, I think, pretty vital. It's pretty, and actually, for me, who likes it, London's the best place to be. The Royal Opera and English National Opera are doing some pretty good new work, which I find very interesting.
And you've been at the National for 50 years. No, you've not. The National has been there for 50 years. and you said recently, I think, that in 50 years' time it will still have fantastic actors, fantastic directors, fantastic plays. But how do you think the nature of theatre will change over the next...
No idea, and that's for you to decide. You know, that really is for you to decide. I've no idea. I'd like to think that for a good few years I'll be involved in it and watching it. But more and more now, I think, you know, what I'm interested in and what really makes me excited is seeing the kind of stuff which I would never have dreamt was possible. The kind of play, the kind of look, the ways of looking at the world. Actually, never mind the ways of looking at the world, corners of the world about which I have no idea. And the great thing about writing for the theatre, I don't know how many people here would like to write for the theatre, but the great thing about writing for the theatre as opposed to writing for film or television is you get it put on, you can get it put on. It's easy to put on, comparatively. All you need are, a few actors who are your friends, and a room somewhere, and you can get it done. And if it's any good, it will have a life. There is a huge premium put, even at our level, on good new stuff. Good new stuff gets fought over. It doesn't have to fight to get put on. I'm not going to say that occasionally there isn't a voice so new, so startling, that it confuses people like me to the point where we can't recognize its talent. But and actually, that does happen to me quite a lot. But I got people around me who I hope do recognize its talent. But the thing is, you can get a play put on. And because it's live in the room on the night, it's always going to be a bit special. And when it's boring, it's specially boring. Do you know, there is no pain so great in the performing arts world than having to sit through a boring play. It's so much more painful than sitting through a boring movie, which I think perversely is a tribute to how much people expect when they go see the theatre. So I have absolutely no doubt that the theatre will remain vital. But what it will look like in 50 years, I don't know.
And what has been your highlight over your 12 years at the National so far?
Well, I don't think there's been a single highlight, but once you take responsibility for a company, for a building, what really excites you are the people who thrive, the people who emerge, the talents who develop. So the actors who have emerged or other actors who have got better, the writers who found a voice, the writers whose voices have become more pronounced. I'm very pleased that it's much fuller than it was 11 years ago. I really like that. I really like, you know, the Barnum and Bailey aspect of my job. Getting out, shouting about it, selling the tickets. These days, metaphorically, you know. And when I think about who actually does the work, people who sell the tickets, I think our marketing department is the youngest department in the theatre because they know how to sell them. And actually, one of the most exciting developments has been again, it's necessary to take you back to the pre-internet age, where really all you could do if you wanted to sell tickets to something was advertise it in the paper and put up posters. If you had a play of particular interest to a particular audience, all you could really do was try and find out where they live and shove leaflets through their door. Now, if you have a play, if we have a repertoire with, you know, which has a play that might be particularly interesting to a teenage audience, a play that might be particularly interesting to an audience that knows about Nigerian culture, a play that uses music of particular interest to a musically engaged audience, you know exactly where to find them, or at least I have people who know exactly where to find them. So that means that the repertoire can be more diverse, and the point of a diverse audience, frankly, if you're in the business of making theater, is not the audience itself. 10 years ago, those who funded the theater were very interested in the audience. It appeared they were never looking at the stage, they were only looking at the audience. But to me, the point of being able to get the diverse audience is to be able to have a diverse repertoire, to be able to support a repertoire that goes off in all sorts of interesting directions. You can do that now.
And what was it like to be sort of director of the National Theatre at 50 years? Was it, like, did you enjoy crafting that programme? What was the whole experience like?
Yeah, I did. I crafted a programme that was about 2.5 hours long, that it went out live on television, and it was a kind of montage of live highlights from the last 50 years. And it was very moving. I realized, you know, I started going to the National Theatre about 40 years ago, so a lot of it I'd seen. And it was extraordinarily moving to have on stage a good few of the actors who had been there in 1963 when it started, and moving in another direction, to be aware that there were another substantial handful who were on stage with Michael Gambon and Maggie Smith and Derek Jacobi and so on, who will also be on stage in 50 years' time. And yes, it's sentimental. It's very sentimental of me to say this, but I was moved by the idea that in 50 years' time, Benedict Cumberbatch and Anna Maxwell Martin and James Corden will be able to say to people your age, yeah, I was on stage with Maggie Smith and she played Desdemona to Laurence Olivier. And Laurence Olivier learned how to act from Ellen Terry. My predecessor, Peter Hall, the director who took the National from the Old Vic into the building on the South Bank, used to be able to trace the way he taught the acting of Shakespeare right back to Burbage. He would seriously say, I learned it from Edith Evans, and Edith Evans learned it from William Pole, and William Pole learned it from, I can't remember. And he would go back through Keane via the Restoration to Burbage. Not sure I believed it, but it was moving. It was moving.
And you're obviously moving away from the National next year, and you've described your role being director as the most exciting and most fulfilling job in the English-speaking theatre. Mm-hmm. So where can you go from here, do you think?
Well, what I can't do, I'd love to start again. I genuinely love to be where you guys are, if any of you guys are wanting to work in the theatre. But that's not the way it works. What I can't do is... And what would be wrong after what will be 12 years at the National would be to look to the public purse to support what I do anymore. I mean, I could do what some of my predecessors have done and just be a director for hire again and go from gig to gig. But I could do, and it would be and it would be to a large degree for me personally a bit of a relief not to have the responsibility. But what I would like to do is find a way of continuing to make exciting theatre and continuing to be available as producer of the kind of theatre which I can't direct myself, but in the commercial arena. In other words, to find a way of making theatre pay for itself. That can only happen in an ecology which is underpinned by a modest degree of public investment. The very fact that, you know, that we've taken the National during the time I've been there from being a business which 40% of which 40% of its income is public subsidy to 18%. That's not happened because subsidy's fallen, although it has a bit. It's happened because turnover has increased. So my colleague Nick Starr and I reckon that we've learned a bit about being theatrical entrepreneurs. And we're going to continue to try to do that, this time without the 18%. But if we didn't have all that in the first place, then all you would have in our theatre ecology would be the kind of jukebox musical end of the West End. It's the fact that there is support for innovation, not just support for innovation, but support for classical work of high seriousness as part of the mix that makes it possible then to dream of doing work of a certain degree of seriousness and of a large degree of innovation in the commercial arena, and that's what I'm going to try to do.
Interesting. Will you be traveling around different theatres or will you have your own venue?
No, that I don't know yet.
And do you think the theatre should be used for political ends? Have you?
Well, I think it's in the widest sense, yes, absolutely. But I think I think the theatre should be politicised in that it should very much be an arena in which politics, in the widest sense, can be discussed. But it's not an instrument of policy. And I don't think it's really an instrument of reform. The most political playwrights, the most successful political playwrights, are masters of paradox. The most successful political playwrights don't really make their minds up. They see things in the round, or they see things from odd angles. There are very few successful polemical plays or polemical evenings in the theatre. In fact, I can only think of one that I've produced in the last 11 years.
Which one?
It was a piece by this. It was a piece by which we didn't even produce ourselves. It was or not by ourselves. Produced by a piece of physical theatre by Lloyd Newson of the DV8 company, and Lloyd made two pieces about religion and free speech. The first one, and actually they were both polemics, the second one particularly. The first one, I don't know if you're aware of DV8's work, they're an extraordinary physical theatre company, and Lloyd has been experimenting more and more by bringing text into his work and by finding highly trained dancers who can also deal with text. The first one was largely focused on the problems that all mainstream religions have with gay people. And it was a verbatim piece made up of testimony from gay members of five or six religions, including the most extraordinary sequence built around the testimony of a gay, anonymous, needless to say, gay imam. He then moved on to make a show about I think largely prompted by stuff that he reckoned he'd discovered while making the show To Be Straight With You. He then made a show called Can We Speak About This? And it was a polemic about what he considered to be the impossibility of discussing radical Islamism. It was not a comfortable evening. It was a challenging and uncomfortable evening, and he was like a man obsessed. I think artists usually aren't. Usually great artists, great writers can usually see the opposite to what they think they think. Lloyd had a big B in his bonnet. The number of times I've seen written about the National Theatre, about theatre in general, that it would never dare to say about Islam what it says about Judaism and Christianity, I can't count that number. In fact, the only time I can think that there has been a show on at the theatre which goes specifically for the radical, extreme wing of any religion was that show.
My final question before I open it up to the floor is that when you came to the National, your first show was Jerry Springer the Opera.
Yes, I didn't direct that. I produced it, yeah.
And everyone said, how bold.
Yeah, it wasn't that bold.
Do you think, are you going to go out in a similarly bold fashion?
I don't know. I don't think Jerry Springer was that bold. Looking back on it, it was just such exhilarating fun. And it was a show about, that was a show which, you know, on the one hand, it was a celebration of gross popular culture, celebrity, chat show culture. On the other hand, it gave it a good kicking. And that's, you know, maybe it would have been bolder if it had been entirely one or the other, but it wouldn't have been as good.
Yeah. Cool. Brilliant. Thank you very much. Now, does anyone have any questions? If you put your hand up and wait for a microphone to reach you, that'd be great. Over here.
I wanted to ask how studying the English tripos has helped you in your career, if it has indeed helped you at all.
Well, I did. I did read English. It helped me, but it... I just said the honest answer is that if I'd been reading a proper subject, I wouldn't have had as much time to make theatre. But I really enjoyed reading English, and I can remember working at unconventional times. Sure, it gives you a familiarity with the canon, but I think, and it certainly encourages you to think critically about texts, old and new. I don't think it's a prerequisite. I think you can certainly make use of it, but there's a danger. And do you want to work in the theatre?
Writing, but probably more poetry than theatre.
Writing?
Poetry.
Yeah, very good. Because I think if there's anybody here who is reading English who wants to work as a director or indeed as an actor, there are pitfalls. There's a way of thinking critically about text, which the English tripos is all about, thinking analytically about text, which can lead you up the garden path if what you want to do is stage or act, embody the text. You have to drop quite a lot of that. I have worked with assistant directors who've come not just from Cambridge, but from all the universities. It is a fact now. This has happened even over the 10 years that I've been at the National. By far now, the greater number of directors come from the universities. They come not just with English degrees, but with degrees. They come at the business of making theatre with a graduate's analytic approach. Great, fantastic. I'm not a fan of the kind of theatre that appears not to come with a point of view, that appears not to come with a degree of thought and analytical intelligence. But on the other hand, I've worked with lots of assistant directors whose reflex is to write an essay, to talk an essay. I don't know how you translate an English degree into writing poetry. I have no idea. And I don't know about how you turn the way you have found how to think when you're doing a degree here. I don't know how you translate that into any other area of life than the theatre. But if you are taking it into the theatre, there are disadvantages as well as advantages.
Over here.
Hi. I have two questions. The first is what you think about London as a theatrical city in comparison to the other big kind of urban theatre hubs in the world, because compared to New York, but also places now like Berlin and Madrid, and what you think makes London is still hailed by many people as being the best centre for theatre in the world, very different from maybe the commercial aspect of Broadway or the very, very fringe, edgy aspect of Berlin. I was wondering what you think makes London special as a theatre city. And the other question is about student theatre, about money in student theatre, and whether your experience at Cambridge, whether you think that the amount of money which is poured into theatre at Cambridge, which is very different from other universities in the country, whether you think that it's more of a hindrance than a help to the in terms of innovation, whether people get too fixated on kind of budgets for shows and less on producing good theatre.
The second question I can't answer because I don't know how much money you spend and I don't know how much money everybody else spends. And I think it's probably different from what it was 40 years ago. The first question is an interesting one. Best, I regularly say best because politicians like to hear best. It is different, and I don't know about Madrid. I have seen a show in Madrid actually, but not so that I would be able to say that I knew very much at all about the Spanish theatre beyond the fact that it is in crisis at the moment because Spain is in crisis and its money has just been taken right away. Berlin I do know a bit about, and Paris I know a bit about. And I know about New York. I would take a long historical perspective on this. Our theatre came of age, our golden age, from about 1585 to about 1625, at a time when the theatre was a genuinely popular art. That on any afternoon in the summer, of the 200,000 people that lived in London, 9,000 of them were at the theatre. That's on any afternoon. There were three theatres on the South Bank, three public theatres on the South Bank, holding 3,000 people each. And during the summer, they were all open. So that's a lot of people going every afternoon to the London theatre. But at the same time, those companies all had patrons, and Shakespeare's company had royal patronage, and they were formally constituted to be available at court any time they were summoned. And a degree of their income, and certainly their legitimacy, came from the court, came from the state. Most of their income came from selling tickets. It was that all the playwrights were enormously confident, intellectually confident, theatrically confident, confident enough to think about big things, to approach big subjects, to write big stories, but always in a way that would be attractive at the box office to the people who are paying a penny to stand, as well as to the people in the galleries, as well as to the court when they had to go. They played the same repertoire at court as they played in the public theatres. There's a lot of record of the same repertoire being played at court as played outside in the public theatres. Gradually, the theatre became more exclusive, as so often happens. The middle classes got hold of what looked like a good thing and started to clasp it closer and closer, or the aristocracy started to clasp it closer and closer to its bosom, and the public element of it, to a degree, fell away. But it was a theatre that was simultaneously popular and aristocratic, ambitious and accessible, and very, very successful, and made several people quite rich. We've never really had a court theatre, not really. The court has been involved, the court has offered patronage. Do you know, when the theatres reopened at the Restoration, the two London theatres were patronised, one by the King, one by the Duke of York, but they were theatres you paid your money, you bought tickets, metaphorically, and you arrived. The French and German theatre is quite different. French theatre was, you know, Molière, good example, started as a popular entertainer with a touring company, playing to the general public. He was hijacked by the court and essentially subsumed by Versailles. The tragedians, the French tragedians of the 17th century were there for the aristocracy only. The German theatre was invented as an instrument of princely prestige, invented at Weimar by Goethe and Schiller, essentially to big up the Principality of Weimar. I'm exaggerating here, but my thesis is that the German and French theatres, German and French performing arts, are court theatres. Their purpose is closely bound up with the prestige and glory of the court. Ours never has been. As a result, cut forward to now, in the highly, highly subsidised, 90% publicly funded world of French and German theatre, you will find a degree of innovation, a degree of experiment, a degree of finesse that you don't often find in ours. But they're playing to their equivalent of what the court then was. There's a lot of theatre going on in Berlin. There's a lot of theatre going on in Paris. Does it ever imprint itself on genuinely popular consciousness the way ours does? I don't think so. It's often wilder and freer and almost always harder to understand, very often impossible to understand. It disappears up its own arsehole far more often than ours does. They have the benefit of knowing that they don't have to appeal to the audience. And indeed, in my conversations with my counterparts, particularly in Germany, the idea that you need to think about the audience is completely alien to them. Not just alien to them, offensive to them. They say, what do we have subsidy for if we have to worry about the audience? The subsidy is about the art. Now, that comes direct from the Duke of Weimar saying, I want a theatre. That comes direct from Louis XIV grabbing it and deciding that it's all part of the great panoply of Versailles. Our court never did that. Has never been interested in doing that. Kind of happy enough to join in. I think the same is the case now. We live here, at our best, with a theatre that still wants to be ambitious, certainly what I went into the theatre for, some of you will be going into the theatre for different reasons, to take stuff that I feel genuinely to be good, genuinely to be complex, genuinely to be ambitious, and to make it as popular as possible. I'm not a great fan in London, and I am pretty London-centric, although, you know, at the National, we get out a hell of a, you know, that we're out on tour and we do our cinema broadcasts a great deal. We are properly national. But I make work from London, and essentially I see work in London, and I'm not a great fan of the kind of theatre that purveys high quality to a small number of people who feel lucky to be there. I'm a great fan of theatre which is of minority interest because it is experimental and difficult and pushing things forward. What I'm not a great fan of is highly polished stuff that is only available to members of the club. That feels to me to be the continent. New York, it's tricky. It's tricky. There used to be, even within my memory, a vibrant New York commercial sector doing unbelievably great stuff with musicals, you know. Going and seeing a proper American musical on Broadway 30 years ago, it was overwhelming. The way they sang and danced, fantastic. Do you know, developed into a form of art of which I always felt we can only dream, a proper Broadway song and dance person. That's as good as seeing a great, great classical dancer or a great classical singer. It's now so expensive and so tourist oriented that Broadway's a bit of a problem. You know, we like going there every now and then from the National because it's fun, because New York's fun, and you can kind of sneak in for 5 or 6 months with something that they think to be enormously highbrow, but is in fact, in our terms, this is not about America. This is really not about America. This is about Broadway. This is absolutely not about American culture. Because on the other hand, to counterbalance that, there's quite a vibrant, not-for-profit scene, but it is entirely funded by American philanthropists. So it is, of course, entirely to their taste. That is sometimes very good, sometimes a little arid and chic. The same people who fund and support high-end American visual arts tend to be the same people who fund the theater. You end up with Robert Wilson if you know his work. It's not to my taste. But Broadway is an image of what happens if you leave the commercial theater to itself. $450 tickets, how can that be good? How can that be good? You know, sometimes it's fun. The Book of Mormon, if you've seen it, is fun. But how can that be good? How can it be healthy? It's not. So I don't know that we're the best. Of course I think we're the best. But I think we're particular. I think we're particular.
Over here.
Hi. Do you think there's a marked difference between professionally trained actors and untrained actors, as in actors who have been to drama school and those that haven't, in your experience?
I'm afraid yes. There are university actors who skip drama school who do extremely well. So that can happen. But my advice to anybody here who wants to be an actor is if you can possibly afford it, and I'm very aware that it's not affordable by most people, if you can possibly afford it, do some postgraduate acting training. I'm afraid I'm pretty unequivocal about that. It's not that it's impossible. You have so much to unlearn as well as stuff to learn. You have to get into your bodies. It's a cliche, but it's true. University actors tend not to be inside their bodies. They tend not to be stage animals. They're imaginative, they're charismatic, they think, and some of them instinctively have it, and it's great. But if you can go to drama school, the thing I regret most not being able to do is acting training. Directing training is tricky. I'm not sure that has been cracked yet. I'm not sure what the perfect way of training a director is. Except I would say, I wish I'd trained as an actor. I wish I'd knew how to design and cut a lady's dress and a suit. I wish I knew genuinely how to light a show. I wish I'd done all that stuff. That when we all think we're so damn clever and we got our damn degrees and you know you become a big deal here and you know by the time I'd done 3 years here, I thought I knew it. And as a director, it takes actually. The quicker you realize as a director that you don't, the more likely you are to be able to be good. But actors, there is that 2 years at Lambdor. I think RADA do a two-year course as well. What I think the Guildhall do a postgraduate course. A lot of the, it's not worth not going to a good, it's not worth going to a bad school. Go, if you can, go to one of the good schools. And here's the thing, audition, get onto the course, and then tell them you don't have the money. Because they won't give you the money, but they know of a lot of people who will help you. It's out there. The help is out there. The theatre profession is full of people who've been where you've been. The theatre profession is full of actors who've made it and writers who've made it and directors who've made it who feel themselves lucky. A lot of them are generous and are in touch with the schools, the drama schools, and can provide help. That is my advice. There you go. That's some real proper advice.
At the very back.
Thanks. This kind of follows on from the last question about London. And I was wondering if you thought that in terms of accessibility, there's a problem with theatre being quite so London-centric.
Yes, there is. There is. And something bad has happened. It is too London-centric, but you know there's lots of different ways of looking at it. Subsidy per seat, the amount of public money spent per seat, is second lowest in London. It's highest in the West Midlands. In other words, the more you spend, the more people want to go. And the more they get used to stuff that isn't mainstream. Starving the regions outside of London of money has meant that a lot of those regions have lost the theatre and concert-going habit and have become more conservative in what they want to see. Outside of London, there are some fantastic theatre centres. But even some of the best ones struggle to fill the house when they don't give the traditional audience what the traditional audience expects. So obviously, more money has to go to the regions. I think it would be a great mistake at this stage to start recutting the cake. But as the cake gradually starts to get bigger, and it'll get a bit bigger. It won't get very much bigger, I'm afraid, not certainly in the foreseeable future. London's got to stay still, and the regions have got to get more. One advantage, I think it is problematic. You know, the National Theatre, with its in proportionately lavish subsidy, is able to. You know, we've just done 9 weeks at the Lowry Theatre in Salford and done the 9 best-selling weeks ever at the Lowry and been responsible, according to the Lowry's calculations, for £9 million worth of economic activity in Salford. Great, we can do that because of the money that gets given to us in London. I think, you know, we're aware of it. We tour a lot. We get the cinema stuff out a lot. But there should there be more money to make theatre, make music, and make everything in Newcastle, Sheffield, Manchester? you're right. It's. I don't think the answer, though, is to start giving London less. It's to start giving everybody else more. And London can stay still for a while.
Over here.
You're mainly known as a theatre director, but you've also made some wonderful films, such as The Crucible, Madness of King George, History Boys. Can you tell us how you got into filmmaking, and are there any plays which you'd like to turn into films which you haven't had the chance to do yet?
I'm not a very fluent filmmaker. I got into filmmaking because I was asked to make the film of The Madness of King George. It was a huge stroke of good fortune. Alan Bennett wanted me to make the film. I think mainly because he knew that he'd still have fun with me, and that as long as I was directing it, he wouldn't be pushed out. You know, the hierarchy on a film set is very clear. The writer is a dog's body on many film sets. The only way for the writer to stay in charge is for the writer to direct. Writers who direct are the only ones, I think, who are entitled to call themselves auteurs. You know, there are some whose stylistic fingerprint is so strong that, yes, they can get people to write films in their idiom. Obviously, there are. But the great auteurs write and direct. Alan doesn't want to direct. So he wasn't really that prepared to allow that material to go onto the screen unless I directed it. And we found a producer who was prepared to allow me to do it and prepared to allow the actor Nigel Hawthorne to play the king. So it was at the time, in the early 90s, that was a pretty unique package. And I tried to get myself instruction in what to do. But essentially, I learned how to do it from the direct photography of that film and from its editor. And continue to try to find out how to do it. But you know, real film directors think through the camera. They always know where to put it. They think in terms of a series of shots. I don't. I think in terms of a scene in a space and then start to work out how to shoot it. And I think that is not a fluent way of making a film. If you know, when I think of the people who, there are several directors, many directors who direct at the National Theatre who also direct films. But if I think of the ones who really, really direct films, Danny Boyle, just think of a sequence from one of Danny's films, the opening of Slumdog Millionaire. I don't think Danny sits down and works out where to put the camera. I think he just knows. He just knows. It's instinct. The camera is a character in the film, in the way he thinks. And that's not me. But that doesn't mean that I wouldn't like another go. although I do feel a little sheepish about it, because I feel there are people who really do have this in their blood, the way I hope I have putting a show together on stage in my blood. And I think if Alan Bennett were there with another one, particularly of the plays that I've done with him, that he and I could see a way of making a film of, then I would feel I had a right to do it. But Truffaut, I'm not.
At the top, in the eaves.
I can't remember. I absolutely can't remember. I didn't direct it. You'd have to ask them that. I first saw Jerry Springer. I don't think, I may be completely wrong about this, I don't think it had its second half when I first saw it. I first saw it at a scratch night at Battersea Arts Centre. And it was only about 35 minutes long, and I thought it was completely brilliant, and thought, no, there's this. And this was before I became the director of the theatre. It took them a long time to persuade me that It took a long time for me to persuade myself that it was the kind of show that could take one of our stages. It was only when I saw it in Edinburgh, actually, the summer before we did it. And I think the second half was them trying to find a way, and succeeding in finding a way, of making it a show that had an interval and could play an entire evening in the theatre. That's all I can remember.
Behind him.
Well, there's so many different ways of being a director and so many different things that directors want to do. Some directors want to control, some directors are almost playwrights. And actually, some directors take old plays and use them as an excuse to project their image of the world onto the stage. And that's sometimes very exciting. And sometimes, if you're producing them, very frustrating. So some directors have a vision of the world and a vision of how the world can be projected in the theatre that they use plays as an excuse or as a jumping off point to project. Some feel themselves to be enablers of writers, of actors. Some feel themselves to be expert interpreters and editors. What makes a good director? Well, everything I say is qualified. I was about to say, and I believe this very strongly, a good director is someone who is consumed with admiration, and I would even say love, for the people who do the things that the director doesn't do. Nothing excites a good director more than an actor being surprising. Nothing gives you greater delight than thinking, I've created the circumstances for these actors to go kapow with each other, for this play to find the right actors and come fully alive. And more exciting that really than a sequence which appears to be entirely the product of a director's imagination. But as I say that, I can think of directors who absolutely drive actors nuts, for whom actors are merely cogs in the wheel and the writer an irritant. And I can think of directors like that who I would never want to be in a rehearsal with, who nevertheless produce good work, tiny number of them. But I think what makes a really great director is a combination of a real sense of a roadmap, a real sense of where it's going, a sense of confidence, but at the same time, a profound respect and love for what everybody else does. It's a job that gets easier as you get older, and then as you start to get even older, it gets harder again because you think, I'm using old tricks. If you're directing professionally in the theater, oh God, when you start, and if you don't feel in the first rehearsal room that you confront, filled with trained actors who know so much more than you do, who have been through the process so many more times than you have, with stage managers who've stage managed endless numbers of shows, with maybe a new play by a writer desperate to make an impact, you think, what the hell right do I have to be here? You've got to think that, but at the same time, you've also got to think, but if I start imposing on everybody my insecurity and my consciousness of my lack of rights to call myself director, what damn good am I to them? You have to, at the beginning of your career, walk that tightrope pretty niftily.
In the second row.
Hi. Obviously, you have many considerations to weigh up when deciding which plays to stage at a national. I was wondering how often do you find yourself having to choose plays to stage that you yourself aren't particularly partial to, that aren't really to your personal taste?
Oh, well, I have pretty Catholic tastes, but plays that I actively don't like, never. Plays that I have doubts about, often. Plays that I wouldn't be doing were it not for the fact that I have a colleague who is absolutely desperate but passionate about it, relatively often. You would be, as a director of a theatre, in really bad faith if you didn't see the merit in, or the potential merit in, absolutely everything you do. And yeah, there are things that we do 20 shows a year, and I direct maybe two of them, and there would be things which, amongst those other 18, that I would never dream of wanting to direct myself. There are also quite often things that I would really like to direct myself, but I think someone else would direct better.
Over here.
Hello. So one of the many things I find amazing about the National is that you have the National studio space and you have the shed, and you give opportunities to emerging theatre companies and people who wouldn't have the opportunity to develop their shows. And they don't just get space, they get money just for a week even in the studio to do that. And it's just something that doesn't seem to exist anywhere else, not in these regional theatres. And
no, because we have the money. To be fair, we have the money.
So that's my question. Is it exclusive to you because of the money, or is it possible that that could spread round? And is there anything that anyone could do here, maybe, to start thinking about a way that people who are talented and should be paid for what they're doing just can't be paid for what they're doing? I don't know if that's sort of what you were saying, you're alluding to, that to do what you're going to do next, but the idea of knowing how to manage those things. Because I think it is a big, in a way, it's an exclusive world for the people who can do this as a job.
Yeah, it's exclusive in that you look at the National Theatre Studio and you think, how on earth am I ever going to find myself there? Is that what you mean?
No, actually, because I think,
I can absolutely, I mean, what I would say is, yeah, as far as the studio is concerned, we really can do that because we have the money. And if you are as handsomely funded as we are, that means, there's a false dichotomy, often, not a dichotomy, but it is often pointed out that those companies and museums which are most handsomely funded are the very ones who raise most money from the private sector. But the two are linked. If you are as funded as well as the National Theatre is, the private money follows. So we're in this incredibly lucky situation of being handsomely funded and also being able to go out and ask people to fund things like the National Theatre Studio, which doesn't necessarily, the National Theatre Studio, which has been around now for 35 years, a place where you don't have to deliver something at the end of the 3 weeks you might spend there. It's there to help you if you're a writer or a director or a theatre artist of any kind, develop a show or just develop your ideas. Really important to be able to do. You can't expect that, an equivalent of that, to be attached to a theatre that doesn't have the kind of funding that the National Theatre does. So I think the quick answer to your question is no, that's not going to happen on anything like the same scale anywhere outside of the National, or maybe one or two other theatre companies which are funded as well as we are. What can you do? Well, Jesus, it is really hard. On the one hand, I mean, you know, I look back to the late 70s. There was the ghost of a fringe compared to now. There was more going on in the Rebs, but it was pretty mainstream. So, I got my first jobs in the Rebs, and also because I was interested in opera. That's one of the reasons why I've always been so, as a director, confident on big spaces, because I was dealing with huge stages right from the beginning. You know, you can get, there's all sorts of ways of getting in. If you're interested in opera, you could try that. But what you do have, although it's tough, is so much more going on. So much more going on the fringe. It's tough because you won't get paid for it. But I think you won't get paid for it. But I think that is how it works now. You can't go on like that forever, and you can't expect young actors who have trained and are looking to make a living out of the craft they've trained for, you can't expect them to work for free very often or for very long. But what you can do if you come out of this system, out of the university system, what you can do is if you really want to, you can get shows on and you can somehow scrape a living together working at something else. It's what artists have done. It's tough. It's really tough. I'm not the right person to talk to about how to get started. The people to talk to about how to get started are the people who were in your position 10 years ago or less. But nobody's going to say it's easy if you want to work in the theatre. And it's wrong to expect people to work for free. But, you know, look around you. There are people here who you know, who you can, at the beginning, do stuff with to get yourself started while you're temping or something. I guess that's the kind of thing that you have to do to get started. I promise you, if you're any good, it will happen. I promise you. The reason I know this is because there are so many people who work who aren't very good. You can have a career in more or less anything. You can probably be a high court judge without being very good. It's the way of the world. So the people who are really good, they always get there. They do always get there. That I can tell you to be optimistic about. And if it turns out that you're not getting anywhere, it's going to be really tough to say maybe it's because I'm not very good, and there's no reason why you should ever write that letter to yourself. But find something that you're good at and move on, I'd say.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question. So, over at the back.
When you receive a play on paper, what makes you want to put it on? What do you think makes a good play on paper?
There's no formula. There's absolutely no formula. A good play just zings at you. If you're running a theatre like I am, if you're on your own, if you're in an office on your own, then you just have to feel excited. And over the years, you find out what it is that excites you, but then something, if you're lucky, comes and completely takes you aback that isn't the kind of thing you think you like at all. If you're at a theatre like the National, I'll tell you the one thing that makes it absolutely certain that it gets put on is that I have such a disparate group of colleagues. If they all say this is great, it gets put on. So, but there really isn't a formula. It's not a very interesting question. Not a very interesting answer. It's a very interesting question. It's a very interesting question. It's not a very interesting answer. The interesting answer would take too long.
Thank you so much. I think everyone here has been really interested tonight. So thank you so much for coming and for giving us so much of your time. Just to let everyone know what's happening in the union this week. On Thursday, we have the debate, "This House Would Send Its Children to Private School." And other than that, there are weekly Ents, and our new relaunched bar is always, well, it's regularly open, selling drinks to everyone at the same price, whether, like all students, whether or not you're members. So do make use of it. But for now, thank you so much to Nick.